romance films from Nick Cage, another long list of films. I really should have thought about how long the movie should have been or the amount of films in one video, because 9 movies is a lot. I have to go through in one video. Starting with Valley Girl. Movies about 2 teenagers falling in love, but one is a part of the city while the other is a part of the rural area of town, and somehow they have to be together while both their friends and families don't really like both of them being with each other. Now, based off of that premise, I was like, okay, it's gonna be boring, right? But this one has a little bit of the over the topness or just kind of the ridiculous stuff. For example, there's this boyfriend that she has, this ex, I guess, who's a complete asshole. And by the end of the movie, both him and Nick Cage, they fight, but this guy fights in karate style, and so it makes it feel out of place, but it's so ridiculous that I don't mind it. There are these moments like that throughout the movie to make it enjoyable to a point where I do like this movie. It wasn't just like lovey-dovey, like, oh, I love you, whatever, you know? Okay, there's some ridiculous shit mixed in between these other scenes or just going to a place where it's like, okay, you know what? I do like this. And then both of the kids, Nick Cage and this other girl, being from 2 different parts of town, is interesting. Seeing both of their friends being like, ugh, who is that? He seems dirty, vice versa to the other friends and families. And so whenever he goes to a party at her house, I think, he gets punched by the boyfriend because he's an asshole. He's gotta be. And then when it's flipped, she goes in the city with him at this club. It's loud, freaking here and there, and she's not used to it. And so it really shouldn't work, but because of the power of, you know, love or whatever, they want to be together. And so they're willing to go through all these hurdles and obstacles, being yelled by parents, being ridiculed by their own friend, questioning why they're even with this person. They go through all that to end up with each other. Finally, it's like, yes, they want to be together. They're going to be together. And that's the end of it. And you know what? I don't remember the other characters. Who are they? There's one guy on the beach eating a lot of food next to Nick Cage. They were eye fucking each other at the beach. What else? The house full of kids, that asshole boyfriend. There's another kid. Yeah, I don't remember much from this movie, from the other characters, but the core of it is 2 people wanting to be together but can't, because for some reason, if you're from a different area or side of town, you can't meet together. There's like this gatekeeping aspect to it, which is bullshit. It feels a bit kind of like Shakespearean in a way, kind of like Romeo and Juliet. Not to think about it, it's like, yeah, you know, it actually is 2 people from different families, or in this case, different sides of a town or whatever, wanting to be together but can't because of bullshit obstacles and shenanigans. It's totally like Romeo and Juliet. And then these 2, they ride off. I think she throws her bracelet away from the other ex, gone away. She wants nothing to do with them whatsoever, while both of them ride off to the night and credits roll. So in the end, Valley Girl, I enjoyed it. I liked it. There's enough ridiculous shit, like the karate fighting at the prom and other moments throughout the film. Moonstruck is basically an affair movie. A girl, she's getting married to this guy, but falls in love with her younger brother whenever she meets him. At first, she's like, this is an animal, not someone that I'm gonna fall in love with. But eventually, over time, through kissing and just talking and all that stuff, she falls for him. I guess it's going the route of the heart wants what it wants, essentially, because she really, really wants Nicolas Cage and doesn't care about Johnny at all whatsoever. He's off screen for like the majority of the movie on a trip, I think. He comes back and he's left hanging. The movie ends with him sitting there all disappointed. He's still a part of the family, but he's not getting married no more. He just left this guy hanging. He's sitting there all disappointed and shit. Having an affair is taboo. Like, there is a section of adult films on a certain website that they're specifically taboo, and so I guess that gets people interested and excited. What I do find funny though is that not only is she having an affair, she's not the only person having it. A member of her family, I think her father, is also having an affair, and so there's 2 affair storylines going on. And my question is, why? Whenever they cut back to her family, her father, whatever, talking to someone else or whatever, I was so bored. I was like, this is not needed. Every time they cut back to it, it feels like adding onto the runtime, and that's it. It's adding really nothing aside from the very end where he's like, stop it, okay. And then her brother's like, I forgive you or whatever. It's like, that was a lame payoff. Why do that though? It feels like it was just adding on to the runtime, which isn't even that long. It's like 1 hour 30 minutes, I think, like 90 minutes ish. I might be like 6 minutes off or whatever, but it did not need to be there. Just focus on Nicolas Cage, the younger brother, Johnny. He's like off, so it's just between these 2 having a fun time, and that should have been it. Instead, we have to cut back to her family side, to Nick Cage and her family side. It's like, no, stop it. And so Loretta, she's conflicted. She said yes, she will accept and is willing to marry Johnny, but then she meets the younger brother, and it's like, hey, you know what? I changed my mind. I fucked up. Can I reverse that? And they do it in the most kind of messed up way. Again, like I said earlier, once Johnny comes back from his trip, it's like, hey, guess what? You're cool with it, right? Are you? A okay, sure, he's totally not cool with it whatsoever. The movie ends up with him again disappointed. It's like, oh damn, okay, kind of messed up. So in the end, Moonstruck, I thought it was all right. Aside from Loretta being conflicted on choosing the younger brother or Johnny, this other family affair, which I don't care for, they keep cutting back to it for time. I think I just wish there was more than just Loretta being conflicted and this other family affair. That's really my only issue with it, because watching her just kissing and having sex with Nick Cage, and then it's like, okay, is that it? Does she feel conflicted? The heart wants what it wants. Is that it to this movie? And I guess it is in a way. So Moonstruck was all right. Wild at Heart is my first David Lynch film, and if this is gonna be his movies, this kind of weird, trippy, dreamlike movies of his, then I'm not sure if I'm willing to watch his filmography, because there are some weird stuff in here, man. Like, this is a road trip movie. Most of it is a road trip movie, but then what happens in between, like, for example, there's a flying witch for some reason. The girl from Jurassic Park, she's like the main girl in this movie, and she sees this at night flying witch next to her, random as fuck. Near the end, Nicolas Cage sees like Princess Peach or whatever, like this woman in pink dress in the sky or whatever, very dreamlike. It's like, what is this? And then there's also this other plot with the mother wanting to hire a hitman to kill Nicolas Cage, and then it's also a crime mystery as well with this fire at the house, and it makes the movie feel not focused at all whatsoever, despite being that it should have been. It should have been a road trip while on the side the mother wants to hire a hitman to kill Nicolas Cage. Based off of that plot, I was really intrigued, and for the first 20 minutes I was like, okay, this is a good ass movie. It's insane. There's blood already. Cage kills a man trying to flirt with his girl, is in jail for like 22 months, and then craziness happens. I really like that. The movie set up this tone of being kind of insane, and I thought that would have been consistent throughout, but it's not at all. And again, it makes it feel unfocused. There is quite a bit of metal and rock music in this movie, so that is a plus. And then to add more into the insaneness of this movie, you got Nicolas Cage singing, acting all crazy and shit. Because the way I grew up watching Nick Cage, or at least I remember, is him talking crazy, being insane, being over the top, like in The Wicker Man or the whole Bees, right? My eyes or whatever. That's how I remember Nicolas Cage and seeing him in bits. It's like 90s, 80s, you know, it's still early on in his career, so maybe he's not comfortable with that yet. He's just doing things, he's very new. But that scene of him singing in the club, really like that, because it is a glimpse of, you know, crazy ass Nicolas Cage. The movie then turns into a crime movie where Lula's house was burned down, and somehow Nick Cage knew like her father or whatever, and that's why he's being chased down by the mother, something like that. The mother's involved, and she really wants Nicolas Cage dead, like really dead, and so she hires a hitman. And that would turn out kind of weird. Like, first of all, she freaks out, she puts makeup, I guess red lipstick, over her face. She goes to a hotel, her boyfriend disappears, he's kidnapped by these random ass people, like stuff like this. It makes it feel unfocused, and so now she's got her own issues going on aside from just wanting Nick Cage dead and hiring a hitman. And then you got Willem Dafoe. I was really excited. I was like, oh, you know what, this is really cool, because there was a big ass middle chunk where I was a bit bored, not gonna lie. I was like, okay, you know, started off really hot until they meet that one girl in like in the desert all blooded up. That was also completely random, one of the random moments. But then once Willem Dafoe comes in, it's like, okay, this is fun again. And he is a crazy ass character sexually assaulting Lula, which is a big part of her character as well, where a man, a big chubby man, like sexually assaulted her. Her mother came in, tried to stop him but couldn't, beats him, amplifies that. And he's also a friend of Nick Cage, so it's super messed up. And then to add on to the craziness, turns out she's pregnant, she has a kid, but then Cage has to go back to jail for some reason because of Willem Dafoe. And so this movie is insane. At the end of the movie, I was like, this movie is like insane. It should have been like this simple road trip movie. And I'm assuming because you have David Lynch, who is a well-known and high-regarded filmmaker and director, he just got some crazy shit going on. Princess Peach at the end with Nicolas Cage and a witch or whatever. There's even a moment near the end where Cage gets out of jail, he gets beat up and gangbanged by these dudes, gets up and like Lula and just runs away. I would have expected him to get killed or the guys to just kind of walk away, but no, he just gets up and yells Lula and runs, meets her at a car. They're standing there, credits roll, and then they start kissing. That's how the movie ends. But even a moment like that's like, okay, you know, unexpected. So I guess in the end, Wild at Heart is a wild ass movie. It really is. It's a movie that doesn't seem focused because there's mother storyline going on, Willem Dafoe coming in, seeing witches and Princess Peach and whatnot. I really think it should have been really focused and consistent of just a road trip movie, having a hired gunman or hitman come after Nick Cage because her mother doesn't like him being with her daughter. That really should have been it. That plot alone sounds really dumb, but also interesting and fun. I would have been on board with that, but instead we got some whatever going on shenanigans, and it makes the movie feel unfocused. But in the end, I still like this movie. Zandalee or Zandalee? It's either one of those on the way you pronounce it. Either way, this is a goddamn affair movie. So in this one, the affair is that Nick Cage is reunited with his old friend, a friend that he has a wife with. She's sexually frustrated with him, and so Nick Cage decides to make a move on her, and she takes it. And that's kind of the plot. Things happen and whatnot. I do find it funny because I was like, wait a minute, the husband? I was like, he looks familiar. And so I had to look it up on Google. It's the same actor from Fast Times at Ridgemont High. So now in the 90s, and I guess 10 years later, they're in different types of roles and different times in their careers. Both Nick Cage and the boy that was jacking off to that pool scene, what's his name, forgot his name. But I do find it funny that they're both in this movie reunited 10 years later in the 90s. So at first she takes a liking into this affair. It's fun, enjoyable, but it is wrong and doesn't want anything to do with him anymore. But then once he does that, Cage gets a bit aggressive, violently aggressive, and he turns into this nice gentleman to someone who's dangerous. And so he like sexually assaults her at this church and wants nothing to do with him anymore, because she goes into his place, finds out that there's another woman that he's been dangling with. She's like, okay, I need to cut ties, but that's a wrong choice. Eventually the husband figures out, obviously it's so evident, she's been missing for like hours. Nick Cage has been taking very long lunch breaks. She always goes out on this run, and that's where they do their mingling or whatever. This all leads into this boat thing where he has a gun, he's willing to kill himself, Nick Cage, or the girl. It leads into this long boat, maybe not long, but boat chase sequence, and it kills the husband. Both Cage and her are mortified. She freaks out, she's scared of it. But then there's this other scene of, I think, Nick Cage talking to this guy in his car that comes back around to kill her by the end of the movie. So by the end, there's an affair and two people died, both the wife and the husband. Nick Cage survived. And so there's not really a happy ending whatsoever, except for Nick Cage, because he's become obsessed with her. After having this affair, he's like, yeah, I got other girls, but you specifically, really like you a lot. And so he has like this thing for her now. It's creepy by the end of it. Oh yeah, also Aunt May herself, Marissa Tomei, is in his movie. I just want to point that out because, you know, it's Aunt May. But yeah, aside from that, this movie I thought it was okay. Another affair, another just whatever type of movie to me. It ends tragically, so I guess that's a bit of a positive. I do like that. There's no happy ending for both this couple because of sexual frustrations and busy with life. It just did not work well with each other. And so in the end, kind of died with Nick Cage being left alone and being like, guess I survived. So in the end, thought this movie was alright. Honeymoon in Vegas, more of a enjoyable movie, more lighthearted, more comedic, more just kind of like, yes, romance, but more of a rom-com, and I do like that. After like 4 movies of either being mediocre or wild shit, having a movie, Sarah Jessica Parker and Nick Cage, being a couple, finally getting married, going to Vegas, it was just a lot more fun. I enjoyed that. But the movie opens up in a very bleak way where Nick Cage is going to his mother's deathbed. She hasn't died yet, but tells him not to get married. Why? What if I want to? But it's so messed up because she dies right after that, and so he's scarred for life, being the last person to see her at a very last moment, but also tell him not to get married. Hence he was very apprehensive to marry. After a while of them dating or whatever, he's like, you know what, let's get married, go to Vegas, leave New York, because there's way too much New York and all of these movies. For some reason New York was like the big thing. They go to Vegas, have some fun. There's some issues there. He loses money to this guy named Tommy, who's the villain I guess of this movie. Pisses off Sarah Jessica Parker, but it's still Vegas, having a fun time, until Tommy comes in, takes Sarah away, and it turns into kind of this getting back to your wife type movie. He wants to get back to her, wants her back, and Tommy, his end goal is just her. She reminds him of his own wife, I think. There's a flashback to it. I think they go to Hawaii, I think, based off this title, Vegas. They're gonna be in Vegas for like the whole movie, but no, they're like airport, they go to like Hawaii, I think. Nick Cage gets there, wrong place, and they have to go back into Las Vegas, but there's a detour. They have some fun, and I thought Sarah Jessica was gonna be oblivious to this. Really not, but kind of is, because she said yes to him. Meanwhile, you have Nick Cage trying really hard to get her back. Airport stuck. He jumps out of the plane of Elvis, which, by the way, Elvis is very heavily influenced in this movie. There's Elvis costumes, Elvis songs, Elvis planes. He jumps out of it, trying to get back to her. And he does, while Tommy's chasing her, trying to get away from him. And by the end, it ends in a happy way of both of them getting together, getting married finally, but in a very Elvis-like wedding. Getting rid of the villain and finally getting his girl back, his wife back, his future wife back, finally getting married. It feels like a fairy tale, you know, beginning, middle, end. There's a good guy and a bad guy. There's no in between. There's a girl involved, and by the end, the main guy wins, the hero wins. And that's what this movie plays out, which I was fine with. It's not like the best rom-com, you know, it's not trying to do that, it's just trying to have some fun. So in the end, Honeymoon in Vegas was a lot of fun. I enjoyed it quite a bit for being just a lot more lighthearted. So just like with Honeymoon in Vegas, this is a much more fun, lighthearted movie, but dealing with real life stuff like being bankrupt and going through a divorce with this waitress, but also making me want to to be like a good and better human being? Because Nick Cage in his movie is just like the perfect human being, you know? He's a cop that's good, well respected by other people in New York. The kids like him, families like him, and everyone likes him. It's just a very wholesome movie, and you know what? Really like that. And I do like the setup of him beating this waitress and the whole point of the tipper. And so he makes her a promise later on where he's like, I'll tip you whenever I win, you know, lottery. His current wife or girlfriend, who is completely selfish, likes herself, loves herself, wins the lottery, $4 million, and he's having an issue of like, oh no, what do I do? I'm supposed to tip this, you know, waitress, and being just genuinely a good person. And he decides to tip her $2 million. At first, she doesn't believe it. This would help her money problems of getting a divorce and going bankrupt. And so somehow this gets out. It goes all over the news and whatnot, on the newspapers, which I thought was funny. Just kind of like 20 years ago, having news come to you on TV, or just kind of way back in the day of on newspapers, seems a bit funny now, but that's just how it was back in the day. I could get on my phone now on social media, which is either for the worse or better. His girlfriend is not happy about it whatsoever. They only have $2 million, but when she does, she gets a painting of herself and luxurious clothes and whatnot. He likes giving these homeless people money. She takes it out and clearly should be with, you know, the waitress, who's also having, you know, financial issues, life issues, work issues. Over time, these two spend time with each other. They're on a date without calling it a date. They have a bond, start to like each other. And then there's issues with his own girlfriend where he gets kicked out. The waitress, her husband comes back, is like, get away. She decides to move out. She has extra money given to her by Nick Cage. They both meet at this hotel. They're in it together. The one thing I did forget about is the trials. I forgot what they're going for trial for, because his girlfriend's there, the waitress is there, and Nick Cage is there. But I'm not gonna lie, I forgot what happened. Kind of zoned out. Either way, it doesn't matter, because by the end, both get together. I really do like this part of the whole city tipping both of them. Just like he tipped the waitress and helped with the city. He's beloved, and so this is the city giving back to them, which I thought was really nice and really just, again, very wholesome, very good. His ex married some other dude. He like got all the money and left, and she's like lonely now, I think, by the end. So she gets a bad ending, not a happy ending whatsoever. But for this waitress and Nick Cage, they get to have a happy ending. They get money of envelopes and checks by the city. The city, inch by inch, dollar by dollar, are tipping this large tip, which is like 600k. And then the movie ends air balloon, where they're like giving out newspapers about wedding, I think. And so in the end, it could happen to you. Overall, it's just like a good movie, you know, just essentially be a good person. One day you'll get, you know, good back in your life, essentially. Again, this is still fiction. Not saying that, you know, the whole city is gonna tip you 600k if you're a nice person, but you should still try to, you know, strive and go towards being a good person, because being an asshole, being a bad person just isn't really nice. So yeah, I do like this movie a lot. It's very wholesome. Leaving Las Vegas. Now, out of the movies here, this is clearly the best one, because it's a raw look into depression and alcoholism. Nicolas Cage is playing this guy who's lost his wife and his son. They've moved out. He's losing his job, and so he begins to drink and plans to drink himself to death, which immediately it's like, okay, this is a very serious movie that will probably end in tragedy, make you feel bad, make you feel depressed in a way. So he moves to Las Vegas and plans to do that, drink himself to death because he's depressed. He has nothing left. He goes to like a motel. Is like, yep, you know. And so being there, he meets a sex worker named Sarah, and this is a job for her. She doesn't like it, but it pays well. She's not very happy in her life. She loses her husband, I think her Russian husband, I think he dies, and so she too is alone. It makes her depressed. And so in this movie, you have two people that are at their lowest. Well, Cage is definitely at his most lowest, and to see both of them meet each other, somewhat have this relationship of kind of being messed up, was really interesting. Their first encounter I really liked, where she's about to like suck him off or whatever, but then he's like, no, I just want to talk. And she's definitely not used to that. And usually when she gets called in for work, it's for sex. But in this case, he just wants to talk, which correlates to her being alone and being like, okay, you know what, this ain't that bad. And I guess Cage wants someone else there right before he dies, because he too doesn't want to be alone. And so throughout the movie, they go on dates. And at first I thought, okay, this is gonna very happy way, you know, he's depressed, he's drinking a lot, he meets a woman, have a bond, and they get married or whatever, you know, like that's what I thought. But it doesn't do that. There's a certain point where it's like, okay, there's no turning back. But throughout this journey, I thought, okay, they seem very happy, but he's still drinking. She allows that and just wants him for the company. That kind of leads into them kind of using each other in a way where both of them are spending time together, but it's not genuine. There are moments of like genuine. At her house, he brings over a girl and have sex with her while Sarah's like, I am using you in a way, but got the feels for him. And so it's like, well, this is a turning point. And I remember looking at the runtime and being like, wait, there's only like 50 minutes left. This is not gonna end happy, is it? And it didn't. So despite Sarah wanting him and kind of using him just for her own personal company, turns out she would be the one to be heartbroken by this because she really wanted some sort of relationship between the both of them, but knew going in he wasn't gonna change. I thought Sarah was gonna be like this life change for Cage, but no, it's not really. He says that he's gonna drink himself to death, and he does that by the end. She goes into a motel room, sees him kind of choking up just in agony and pain. They do it for one more time, and like, he's dead. He actually dies on his deathbed, and she's just sitting there just like, yep, he's dead. And then the next scene, she's talking to her therapist, talking about how despite knowing that he wasn't gonna change, still pretty much loved him in a way. I just didn't expect that. Like, I really thought his life was gonna change around and be for the better because of Sarah, but no, he said that he was gonna drink himself to death, and he did it by the end of the movie. There's no saving this person at all. He had lost everything at his lowest. There was no one person that was gonna change his decision. Even if it's like a glimpse of happiness with Sarah, it's like, okay, he can change, right? Nope, he's already depressed, already drinking. There's no turning back for him whatsoever. So in the end, Leaving Las Vegas, it's a really damn good movie. It's a romance film in a way. I guess anyone were to ask me what's my favorite romantic film now, it's gonna be this depressing film, which makes sense. It's talking about alcoholism and depression. It really is just kind of this raw look and kind of realistic in a way, looking to someone who's alcoholic and they can't really turn back on that. They're willing just to kill themselves because of depression and just feeling useless in a way, no point in living whatsoever. So go watch this movie. Well, hold on, if you don't mind thriller slash takes on realistic, you know, human things, I guess, then don't watch this movie. If you want to watch something that's relatable, know someone that's alcoholic, then yeah, sure, hold on, maybe don't. Leaving Las Vegas is a damn good movie. City of Angels. I'm really excited for this movie because Cage is an angel watching over humanity alongside with a bunch of other angels, and it sounded interesting. There's a certain point where they explain why they're here and how they could change, you know, fates and whatnot, and I was way more interested in that than the actual like romance or whatever, because halfway through it's like, oh yeah, this is a romance movie. Like, yeah, I forgot. Like, he's in love with this heart surgeon because not only is she a human, but she has this passion and determination to not give up. And with Cage being an angel, he's just like, yeah, you know, I'll watch. He can help because I think he like heals a person. The movie doesn't dive too deep into the actual powers of the angels. They're just kind of there essentially with no explanation, which is fine. But it's more implied that they can change, you know, everyone's reality and like fates on whether if they die or not. Even the heart surgeon's like, sometimes I feel like none of it is in my hands. It's like destiny. So there's that aspect to it as well. And the angels are just kind of there watching. Being creepy, by the way. Every room that the characters are in, Cage is in the corner just looking and listening like, this is a bit creepy, you know? So I was way more interested in that and the rules and why things happen that the way they do, why people die a certain way, how come there's a time limit or a clock on certain people, all that stuff. I was way more interested in that than the actual he wants to be a human being because, you know, you're free will and all that stuff. It's like, yeah, but the rules, you know? But they didn't dive into that, which was fine because he meets an angel that jumped and became a human being. The reason for, again, free will, get married, have a wife, have a family, not be bound by rules and just waking up at sunset, standing there looking at the sunset, and they're doing it at night. It's some kind of like daily thing that they do for some reason. But this angel, he had a choice. He made the choice of giving up these rules and bounds of watching human beings and humanity and then living in it, having free will. And that's what Cage wants. He tells his angel buddy all the time like he wants to do this, and this angel's neutral. He doesn't despise humanity, he just does what he's told and that's it. He has no problem with that. But for an angel like the guy in the hospital or Cage, they want something more. They want a choice. And to them, just like with human beings, they want free will, they want a choice. But then whenever Cage decides to become a human being, guess what? The doctor dies quickly right after he becomes a human being. She dies because her time is up. So just moments after becoming a human being, he's felt lost and grief and I guess anger as well, because he asks his angel friend, why is he being punished? And he's like, no, you know why. It's just the way it is. Life is, and you have to move on from that essentially. So this movie is kind of like, I feel like there's a bunch of movies out there dealing with topics like existence, why we do the things we do or why they even exist. Why do things happen? They just kind of do. And this movie does it well. Is life really pre-planned or destined? Who knows? Maybe me talking on this mic right now, releasing this video, it's pre-planned, or maybe it's not. I would like to think that it's not. I'm just doing whatever I want. This movie asks that question, and it's up to you whether you want to believe it or not. So in the end, City of Angels, it was a good movie. I just wanted a bit more on the angel side of why they exist, how come they don't intervene, but just more of that. The Family Man. It's a simple movie. Very simple, predictable movie. My one gripe with the movie, though, is the setup. Because Cage is a well-off businessman who somehow the next day, whenever he wakes up, he has his family, he doesn't have this company, and he's got kids. And he doesn't know what to do with that because for, I think, 12 or 13 years, he's been working hard at being wealthy, living alone, doing whatever he wants. But the way they did that is just one day, he meets Don Cheadle and then goes to sleep and then wakes back up next to his wife and family and kids. It's like, why? Don Jeter comes back in his nice car or whatever, being like, it's a glimpse. What is a glimpse? Like, a possible future or whatever. And it is just that, a possible future of what if he would have chose his girlfriend over at the company, moving to the UK, making all this money. And throughout the movie, at first, he's like freaking out, doesn't like it. Tries going to the places that he was back on his normal life, but the old lady doesn't recognize him. The guard doesn't recognize him. And so now he has to live with this glimpse of a normal life, the struggle of not having fancy cars. He's driving a van because all he did was money. He would give out money, or money would be the solution. Doesn't have all that money no more. He learns that not all the problems that he has can be solved with just money, like not being there for his daughter during her bike ride during Christmas Day, leaving for Christmas Day and leaving his family and friends all alone while he goes out and searching for his quote-unquote normal life. He now has to go bowling, which looks like fun. He has to go bowling now. He has fun with that. And so over time, he starts to, you know, buy into this life, starts taking a liking into it, and just learns to be thankful for it because he doesn't have any of this. Earlier in the movie, when Don Cheadle was robbed at the store, he asks Cage, like, what do you want in your life? He says nothing. And so when everything's all done, the glimpse is over, it's back to normal. This lady was waiting for him by this door, left her hanging, goes to his wife, or not wife, but normal other world wife, and convinces her to stay so that they can have a kid, have a family, and he can, you know, have a family while also being well off in this company, or quit that job and just have the normal life and that other life. It's a simple, you know, movie. A man learning how to be thankful for having this other life, having a family, whatnot, not relying on money too much, can't do everything alone. You need someone else, essentially. So I liked it. Probably the most easiest film to just kind of watch because it was so entertaining. You know, it's like, okay, this is very simple, predictable, but at a fun time. And that was it for the Nicolas Cage romance films. And again, I like most of them. Maybe I don't hate romance as much as I think I do. There were a couple that are like, yeah, whatever. But overall though, 9 movies, and I think like most of them I liked, they were good. Especially Leaving Las Vegas. Even now I'm still thinking about it, like, it's just really good. Alcoholism, all that stuff. But then you also have very lighthearted, just very nice movies, like Cage being a nice person and It Could Happen to You and all that stuff. So that's it for me. This has been The Road So Far, and thank you for watching.